السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. وبعد, the title of today's lecture is Thresholds. A threshold is a doorway. جو چوکھٹ بولتے ہیں اردو میں, دروازہ. I want to begin with something that my father used to tell me many, many times repeatedly when I was young. And that is some lines from Shakespeare's play Julius Caesar. And these lines are of the lines of Brutus, where he said, "There is a tide in the affairs of men, which taken at the flood leads on to fortune. Omitted, all the voyage of their lives is bound in shallows and in miseries." I think it's a very beautiful line, a very beautiful set of lines. And if I was to reduce them and to get the essence of that in two words, the two words are choice and timing. Choice and timing. When I teach leadership, one of the exercises I do is I ask people to draw their lives. We do that, those of you who have been to the Leadership Excellence course, the LEC, you have participated in that. Those of you who haven't been to the LEC, at some point when we have it again, we are having one now in Kuwait in February, so you can come there. Otherwise, whenever, wherever it is, different countries, you can participate in that, inshallah. So I ask people to draw their lives. We draw a line across a large sheet of paper, a large chart of paper, and we draw a line across the middle of that. And we tell them to draw incidents from their lives going back in their memories as far back as they can remember. Earliest childhood memories from there up to the present time. And I tell them to draw the happy memories above the line and the sad memories below the line. And then we do a whole exercise of interpreting those memories. And I ask them to identify the thresholds in their lives. I want you to reflect on this in terms of your own life. And one of the things that you will realize is that life is not equal. Not every incident is equal to every other incident. There are incidents which are very highly significant and which change the course of your life. And there are other incidents which are mundane, usual things that happen. And this has nothing to do whatsoever with whether or not you enjoyed something or you did not enjoy something, quite irrespective of that. The actual incident may be an incident which you really loved and you enjoyed, or vice versa, it might be an incident which is which you didn't like, which you disliked and so on. But it can be a life-changing incident potentially, and that would depend on the kind of choice you made. Now I define a threshold and I call these critical incidents. So I define a threshold as a critical incident or a critical decision where the choice you made opened a new destiny for you. Those of you who have attended the Aqeedah lectures, I have explained this whole issue of destiny as clearly as I could. And my understanding of destiny is that we have limited choice. Allah has given us limited choice. And that choice relates to the doorways that we want to open and walk through. What is inside that doorway, the route, the road that that doorway opens onto is written. But we have the opportunity to open this doorway or that doorway. And depending on which doorway we walk through, a new route opens for us. So therefore, it's very important to reflect on life, and that's the reason why we draw, because that's the way of capturing the memories. Otherwise, if you don't draw them, then the memories are there. Obviously, they're your memories. But they kind of float around in your mind in a sort of soup. And you can't really make sense of them. Lots of things go back and forth and so on. But once you put them down on paper, you draw them. And there's a key element to drawing which is not there in writing, because the picturization accesses another part of the brain, the right part of the brain, the right brain function, which is to look at pictures and see patterns and so on. So, I mean, I'm not doing a lecture on psychology here, so let me stay out of that. But the point is that there is a reason why we do all that. So, if you want to do that exercise at home, I suggest that you do that. It's a very eye-opening exercise. And when we look at those patterns, you will find that in all our lives, we have self-replicating patterns. We have patterns which repeat themselves. And this self-replication can be positive or negative, both ways. So we fall into some positive patterns in life, and you find that you consistently make good decisions and they open good things for you. Or you fall into negative patterns and you find that consistently you make negative decisions and it ruins your life. And many times you might have seen with friends of yours where you might have said, well, why does this person do the same stupid thing over and over again? You know, you might find that, you know, somebody is taking a wrong decision, they do the same thing again and again and again. Maybe they have a job and they lose the job, and they go into another company and they lose that job also, and they go to the third one and so on. And when you look at it, only the name of the company has changed. What happened to them is the same thing. What happened in company A, the same thing happens in company B, same thing happens in company C. The only thing which changes is the name of the boss or the name of the company. Nothing else changes. And you might say, well, you know, why does this person do the same stupid thing over and over again? And the reason that happens is not because they are trying to ruin their lives, but because they don't understand what they are doing. They don't understand the pattern that they have fallen into. And if you don't understand the pattern rules you. The only way of getting out of negative patterns is to recognize the pattern and break that pattern. And then you find that a new destiny opens for you, a new doorway opens, and then you find that life has improved and has straightened out. The reality is that history is only useful in terms of the lessons that it teaches us. There is no other use for history. History is useful only for the lessons that it teaches us. And many people, we don't learn from history for two reasons. One is because we are too busy in our transactional stuff, so we are, busy being busy. Or we are afraid to recognize facts. We are afraid to recognize facts. The reality is the fact doesn't change because you don't want to recognize it. It does not change. If something is right, it is right, whether you like it or not, whether you agree with it or not, right? This is what you tell to the people who are not yet Muslims, and you tell them that just because you don't want to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it does not mean that Allah does not exist. It does not mean that there is no day of judgment. It does not mean that your life will be on some other way of ending. No. And so also, for people who refuse to recognize the mistakes that they make, if you don't recognize the mistake, it does not turn the mistake into something good. If you don't recognize the mistake remains a mistake. And it will continue to affect you. The only thing that happens when you refuse to recognize mistakes is that it takes away your ability to correct those mistakes. Because since you don't see it as a mistake, it takes away your ability to correct those mistakes. So it's a very, very stupid thing to do, but many people do that. Now, however, assuming that you are not from either of these categories, let me suggest that you do this exercise for yourself and identify these thresholds. And when you have done that, then you ask yourself the following questions. This whole text and everything else will be on the site, so you don't have to take notes now, but do read it. First question. When you look at a critical incident, a threshold in your life, which changed your life one way or the other, positive or negative, you first reflect and try to see in your mind, what did I do then? What did I do on that occasion? What did you actually do? And remember, it's eminently possible for you to color those facts and to make it look good and so on and so on. Eminently possible. Nobody on earth can change that for you. It's your life, you are reflecting on it, and you can make it look as nice as you want. Except one thing. If it wasn't nice, it's not going to change because of the color you're giving it now. It's as simple as that. So ask, what did I do on that occasion? First thing. Second question, what other options were available to me at that time? Once again, very tough to do, because you're really going to feel some pain here. What other options were available to me at that time? Ask them. Ask this question. Third question, why didn't I see those options? Or why did I see them but not use them? The option was available, but either I ignored it, or I saw the option, but I chose not to take that option. Why? Number four, what would have happened to my life if I had chosen that option instead of the option that I actually chose? And then, of course, going forward, what do you want to do now with your life? My brothers and sisters, I seriously suggest that we should sit down and think about these questions. As I was coming down, I got an email from Sheikh Muhammad Chippy, who was here, and many of you met him. He said that I'm crossing over from the UK to Netherlands, and I'm going to meet a brother who has been told, he's 31 years old, and he has been told that he only has a few hours to live. And he asked me, what advice should I give him? So I told him whatever I had to tell him. And my point is that at least that brother knows that he has a few hours to live. I don't know that about myself. And my submission to you, with all due respect, is you don't know that either. You do not know that either. And therefore, it is eminently necessary for us to reflect on our lives and to stop fooling ourselves and to stop playing games with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and stop taking chances with the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please understand, all the people in the world can give you any number of dala'il, any number of proofs that something is right when that thing is actually wrong. Not one of those will help you when you stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you did something which was wrong, that thing does not turn to right because your this one and that one and this friend and that friend or whoever told you that that thing was okay. That person who gave you that dalil, that thing was okay, will be running for his own life on that day when you are standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That person is not going to come to your aid. He cannot even talk. He cannot even say anything. And unless you correct yourself today, both you and that person are in serious trouble. It's my job to tell you. I cannot force you. And on the day of judgment, I cannot also stand there and help you either. So please, wake up and take the right decisions. Allah mentions, subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the issue of choices. And He told us very clearly that we have been given these choices. And we have been given the criteria to judge and see which the better choice is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Balad, He said, وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. We have shown the two roads. We have given the hidayah guidance to the two paths. The path of good and the path of evil. In Surah Al-Kahf, which today is Jumu'ah, I'm sure all of you have read the surah. Those of you who haven't read it, read it before the day is over, because this is the sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Say, my Rabb is Haqq, the truth is from your Rabb. And the one who wants to believe, let him believe. And the one who wants to disbelieve, let him disbelieve. And please understand, this does not refer only to kufr and iman. Does not refer only to shirk and iman and tawheed, no. This refers to obeying or disobeying every single order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Every order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This refers to every single order. So please understand this and do something. So each of these places is a threshold and it opens a new door to destiny. And as I said, that destiny is written. Once you cross that threshold and you enter that area, that world, then that is written. But the good news, and the good news is that maybe you opened a door for whatever reason and you entered that world and you suddenly discover that this is not the world that I want to be in. There is something seriously wrong with this road that I am traveling on. Unlike in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this opportunity. And that opportunity is, you can always turn around and go back. You can always turn around and go back out of the same door. And now you are back in the corridor with doors on all sides. And you go and knock on another door and you take a new path. As long as you are alive, there is imminent opportunity to turn around and remake your life. As long as you live. But the minute you die, then that road on which you were walking by yourself turns into a travelator. That turns into a moving walkway. That road turns into a conveyor belt. And you cannot get off. You can't get off. And that conveyor belt will go to wherever it is going. As long as you are alive, the road is stationary, it's not moving. You are moving. The minute you die, you stop moving, the road starts moving. And takes you to wherever you were headed. And that's the reason why it's very important for us, while we are alive, to make sure that we are on the right road. And if we are not on the right road, to get off that right road. To get off that wrong road and get onto the right road. Very, very important. So let's see why people make bad choices even though they know that they are bad. Why do otherwise intelligent people act in such stupid ways? Why do people choose deliberately destructive destinies when there are far better choices? Why do we do that? Three main reasons. Number one, ignorance. You don't know whether it's good or bad. Ignorance. And that's the least serious of the reasons. Our religion is a religion which is based on knowledge. It's a knowledge which gives person superiority. Not just having the knowledge, but practicing that knowledge. As they say, a picture is worth 1,000 words. And my addition to that is, an action is worth 1,000,000. Knowledge which is not acted upon is a waste. And can become a proof against us on the day of judgment. And on that day, those who deliberately disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or who did not follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, will not be able to say that they didn't know. Because ignorance is not a defense in law. It's our job to find out. It's our job to clarify doubts and to correct our ways. Otherwise, the knowledge will trap you and you cannot blame that on somebody else. And that's why I say the most ignorant one is not the one who knows the least, but the one who knows but will not act on it. In fiqh, a hunting dog, if you train a hunting dog and you send this dog to catch a rabbit or catch a deer, then you can say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar and release the dog. Now the dog runs, and obviously it runs very fast, so it takes you some time to get there. Now when you get there and you find that the dog has caught the rabbit or has caught the deer or whatever it was catching, and that animal is dead, you can still eat that animal, it is halal. You do not have to make zabiha of the animal, that dog did the zabiha for you. It was a trained dog and it did what it was trained to do. You said Bismillah Allahu Akbar before you release the dog, and the dog killing the animal is halal for you. Right? Now, you release the dog and the dog disappeared and you followed the dog, but when you got to the animal, you find that there are two dogs. There is your dog which is also there, And there is some other stray dog, we don't know where this dog came from. Somewhere this dog is also there. Both the dogs are at the animal and the animal is dead. Now can you eat the animal? No. Why? Because you do not know which dog killed the animal. You do not know. Both the dogs are there, and the last time I checked, they don't talk. So, you don't know which one killed the animal. Therefore, the animal is by default haram. Even though, in fact, your dog may have killed the animal, the other dog maybe came 10 minutes later or something. But since we don't know that, what do you do when you don't know? You err on the side of caution. So, therefore, that animal is not jais for you. It is haram. And that is why one of the Salafus Salihin, one of the ulama said, knowledge gave even the dog superiority over another dog which did not have that knowledge. It was the training, the knowledge gave superiority to one dog over another one which didn't have the knowledge. And therefore it is very important for us to understand that we need to acquire knowledge and we need to live that knowledge, we need to apply that knowledge in our lives. And Allah Jalla wa Ala, in Surah Al-Jum'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَصْفَارَ بِئْسَ مَثَلُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهَدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Which means the likeness of the example of those who were entrusted with the Tawrat is like the example of a donkey who carries a huge burden of books. It's got loaded with books in both the panniers. But the books do no good to the donkey. Because for the donkey, it's only a burden. It's just carrying a load. The books are not doing any good to that donkey. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this example and said that the person, the individual, and remember this does not apply only to the Jews. It does not apply only to the ulama. It applies to anyone who knows anything. Even if it's one hadith, one ayah, one good thing that the person knows. And if he or she is not applying it in their lives, then they are like a donkey carrying a load of books. And therefore to know the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but still to disobey them is to invite disaster. So that was the first reason why people make bad choices, ignorance. And the solution for that is, find out, learn. Second reason, I told you there are three reasons. Second reason why people make bad choices is because of greed. Greed. And this is the second most powerful reason for making bad choices. Shaitan plays games and shows us his shortcuts to great wealth and name and fame. And he uses the strength of a person to trip him up. For a scholar, the shaitan uses the knowledge that the scholar has to find loopholes to justify the disobedience of Allah. The scholar gives fatwa that apparently make haram into halal, forgetting that one day he and his fatwa, as well as those who followed him, will stand before the one in whose name those false fatwa were given. Today there are many people, so-called ulama, who have made interest halal. They have made interest halal, right? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly made it haram. There are those who have made mixing halal income with haram income permissible and have even prescribed percentages for this mix. And some people said up to 15% of haram is permissible. And some other people were more kind and they said up to 35% is permissible. So it is permissible for you to mix 15% of volume of 100 ml of milk. If you have, it is permissible for you to mix 15% of that volume urine and drink it, and this is jais. How many of you would like to do that? And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not declare war on the one who does this. At the most, you might say Majnoon is crazy, but beyond that, there is no Jahannam for this. But there is Jahannam for somebody who mixes haram income in halal. So this is the kindness of the ulama. And what about the kindness of the Rahmatul Lil Alameen? Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We know from his hadith, he said that in 100 dirham or 100 dinar, if there is one dinar of haram, it makes the other 99 also haram. So what percentage is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam permitting? Nothing, zero, 0%. 0%. Because even if it is 1%, 1 out of 100, he said that one will make the other 99 which are halal into haram. So why do people give this fatwa? You must ask them. There are people who have permitted gambling, which we know is haram. There is no doubt whatsoever. We have the dalail of the Quran and the Sunnah. But people say, some people have given the fatwa to say gambling is halal. There are people who have given fatwa to say smoking is jais. And they use istilahat, they use technical terminology in the Sharia, which of course most people don't understand what they are talking about. So they say, nahi, haram nahi hai, makruh tahreemi hai. It is not haram, it is makruh tahreemi. Now most people think it's a good deed. Huh? Let me do makruh tahreemi. Let my whole life be filled with makruh tahreemi. Because it's a nice sounding big word, no? Very, very imposing kind of word, makruh tahreemi. Like you say it like this with a ha nicely. Makruh, first and foremost thing to understand is the issue of makruhat did not exist at the time of the Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhim ajmain. They knew only two things, halal and haram, khalas. What Allah does not like, we do not do, period. No complication. Later on, and of course we don't criticize the ulama, alhamdulillah, the purpose of the mufti tries to make life easier for the people. Therefore, where there is some flexibility, the mufti gives that flexibility. Yeah, he should give the flexibility also, nothing wrong with that. So therefore, these terminologies were introduced into fiqh, which is makruh, and in makruh there are two kinds, makruh tahrimi and makruh tanzihi. Makruh tahrimi is extremely bad, almost to the point of haram. And makruh tanzihi is also bad, but not as bad as the other one. So those people who say, ya makruh ich hai, bolna mai jaheli chu. Idiotic. There's a wonderful saying in English. You have a choice. Keep your mouth shut and be thought of as a fool, or open your mouth and dispel all doubts. Right? So it's better to keep your mouth shut. Or ask people questions. What, first of all, please explain to me what is makruh before I tell you this or that. Better to ask, because then you can't be wrong. Somebody will explain what makruh is to you. Right? So makruh tahrimi. They say, no, cigarettes are okay, they are makruh tahrimi. So your whole life now, you are running cigarette factories and companies and selling cigarettes and buying cigarettes and smoking cigarettes. And may Allah protect you, and may Allah put that sin on the top of on the heads of those who gave you that ijazah, which didn't exist in the first place. How can manufacturing and selling cancer sticks be halal? What religion is that? Not Islam. So, all your life, makruh, tahrimi, almost to the point of haram you have been doing and living, and your compliant ulama have been sanctioning that. May Allah save you from the evil of that, because you didn't know. But how are they going to answer? And also, if I want to be truthful, then I have to say, how will you answer? Because you can't just walk away and say, well, you know, so-and-so told me. No. It's your job to find out. And the latest of this fitan is the people who have made music halal, which Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly prohibited, which the Quran prohibits, which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly prohibited in so many words. But there are ulama who have made it halal. And there are all of us people who only look for these loopholes. So we are very happy. And the moment somebody in the middle of your dancing, somebody tells you that this is haram, say, no, ask this alim, you know, he told me it's haram. And they have invented a thing called beatboxing. I don't know how many of you have heard about beatboxing. What is beatboxing? Beatboxing is to make the sound of the musical instrument with your voice, with your tongue. Now see the insanity of this. I mean, may Allah protect us. Only insane people can have this logic. The instrument is haram, but the sound is not haram. And we are talking about music. Inna lillahi wa inna ilaihi rajiun. So if I take a guitar, and this example I gave one of them, and he had no answer. I told him if I buy a guitar, and I put four legs on this guitar, and I put a glass top on the guitar and I convert that into a coffee table. Is it halal or haram? So you are telling me the guitar is haram, but if I take out the sound of the guitar with my tongue, it is jais? And they try to interpret that as singing. What do you call, what is a song? A song are words which are recited in a tune. Without the words, there is no song. There is only a tune. T-U-N-E, which is a four-letter word for M-U-S-I-C. Who are you fooling? You want to fool Allah? You want to fool Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made haram, what Allah made haram, is haram, will remain haram till the day of judgment, no matter how many people want to give fatwa in favor of it. Please understand this very clearly. Nobody has the right to make halal into haram or haram into halal. Why do these people do that? Because of greed. They are looking for money from those people who are doing these things. They want to be popular. You want to be an alim to whose majlis so many people will come. You want to have this great conference which you are running with beatboxing in it. So you attract a lot of young people. And those young people come and say, oh, but you know this sheikh so and so said it is jais. So now he gives you a ticket for your conference and you pocket that money and you do a fundraising in that and you have beatboxing. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. Making haram into halal in the name of Allah. My brothers and sisters, people forget that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the pen has been lifted and the ink has dried. With respect to our risk, the only choice that we have is which source do we want to take it from a halal source or a haram source. The quantum of risk does not increase. The quantum of sustenance does not increase and does not decrease, no matter which source you pick. What sense does it make, therefore, that we pick a source which is haram, about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in a different context, وَفِي بُطُونِهِمْ إِلَّا النَّارِ. They are filling their bellies with nothing but the fire. And the third, first reason why we make bad choices is ignorance. Second reason we make bad choices is greed. And the third reason we make bad choices is peer pressure. Third and most powerful reason for making bad choices and for going through the wrong doorway is peer pressure. The kinds of friends we have, the kind of company we keep. Friends are very important in life. Good friends are very important in life. And about the others? About our cool friends? What about them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned us about the cool friends. And He said in Surah Al-Furqan, وَيَوْمَ يَعُضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَىٰ يَدَيْهِ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا يَا وَيْلَتَى لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خَلِيلًا لَقَدْ أَضَلَّنِي عَنِ الذِّكْرِ بَعْدَ إِذْ جَاءَنِي وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِلْإِنسَانِ خَزُولًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and remember that day when the zalimun, when those who have oppressed themselves, those who have committed sins, those who have disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bite their hands. See the beauty of the descriptions of the Quran. What does a person do in regret? What is the body language for regret? What is the gesture for regret? You bite your finger. I wish I bought that lottery ticket. I just missed by one number. Regret is what? You bite your hands. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, they will bite, they will chew up their hands up to their elbows. But all that bloodletting will not help. Will not help. They will bite their hands and they will say, oh, I wish I had taken a path with the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they will condemn themselves They will condemn themselves. They will say, woe to me, lanat on me. I wish I had never taken so and so as a friend. They will name fulanan. They will name the person. I wish this person was never my friend. Indeed, he led me astray from the Quran, from the reminder, after it had come to me. And shaitan is ever a deserter of man in the time of need. And that is why the shaitan will say, فَلَا تَلُومُونِي وَلُومُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. He will say, curse yourself. Don't curse me. Hey, curse yourself. I only suggested to you. I didn't grab you by the scruff of your stupid neck and drag you on this path. I only suggested to you. You took the decision. You took the decision. See the beauty of this thing. Huh? All of you saw the billboards. Night of sin. Greatest party in the world. Actual night. See the beauty of the deception of shaitan. He does not keep anything hidden. He does not keep anything hidden. He is calling sin, sin. He's not hiding it. He's saying night of sin. Absolutely nothing hidden, clear and visible. And that great party, whether it's in this hotel or that club, just try and walk in there without paying for it. No way. No way. It's not free. Only the house of Allah is free. You have to pay. They will make you pay. You have to pay a fee, or you have to go and beg and plead with another idiot who is going there and paying the fee to pay your fee, so you go as his guest. Shaitan closes all doors. You will not be able to say, Allah, I did not know what was there. You didn't know what was there. What about that big billboard which said sin? Say, oh Allah, no, I only understand Arabic. I thought sin means years. Kibaru sin. I didn't think it is. La hawla wala quwwata illa billah. And you can't say, Allah, you know, I just accidentally happened. No accident. You passed through the gate. You bought a ticket. You gave the ticket to the guard. The guard tore the ticket for you. You entered. Nothing is hidden. Clear. So when you stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no escape routes. Shaitan closed all the escape routes. And when you went in there with your eyes wide open, and you went in there knowing what you were going for. Now, brothers and sisters, please save yourselves. Don't worry about all these dalail that people give you. They don't understand what they are doing. And on the day of judgment, believe me, if you follow the dalail, both of you will be in a place which is not funny. In one hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the greatest torment for parents will be that they will see their children being thrown into the hellfire, and they will know that they were the cause for that. Listen very clearly. Today we are living in a world where the source of misguidance are parents. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. Allah gave you the position, O mother, and Allah gave you the position, O father, because you can mislead your children. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the greatest regret will be parents will see their children being thrown into the hellfire, and they will know that they were the reason for it. My child is being thrown into the hellfire because I gave my child the dalil for what he did. I told my child, no problem, it's fine. You will see your child burning in Jahannam, and you will know that you are the cause for that. And then you will join your child there. Make no mistake. Do not make any mistake. I am only narrating to you the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Guide your children properly. Don't misguide your children. Take the road of safety. If you don't know, ask. If you have a doubt, stay away, desist. Don't give them false dalail which will put them into trouble and they will put you also into trouble. What kind of parents are you? You have no mercy on your own children? What kind of parenting is this? Please. What about the ones, the good friends? What about the ones who guided properly? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين يا عبادي لا خوف عليكم اليوم ولا أنتم تحزنون الذين آمنوا بآياتنا وكانوا مسلمين ادخلوا الجنة أنتم وأزواجكم تحبرون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, friends, al-akhila, friends, and this is the closest form of friendship in Arabic. Al-khalil is the closest. Akhila is the plural of khalil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, friends, such close friends on the day of judgment will be enemies of one another. Will become enemies of one another, except the muttaqun. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me friends who will remain my friends on the day of judgment. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you friends who will remain your friends on the day of judgment. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me a friend for those who are my friends so that I can remain with them on the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, friends on that day will become enemies of one another. Except al-muttaqun. And it will be said to the muttaqun, my worshippers, no fear shall there be on you on this day, nor will you grieve. Fear is for the future. Will I be put into Jahannam? Allah says, don't worry. You will not be put. You will get Jannah. And grief is for the past. What did I do? Alhamdulillah, you lived a good life. You had good friends. You made tawbah. Allah forgave you. So the life that you, there is no grief and there is no fear. لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. And Allah said, you believed in our ayat and you were Muslims. So enter Jannah, you and your wives, in happiness. Some of you are saying there's no escape from them even there. But believe me, all their evil will go away. They will be the woman, the believing woman will be 70 times more beautiful than the most beautiful of hosts. And all whatever you dislike will not be there. And whatever they dislike in you will not be there. And it will be a beautiful companionship. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give all of us such wives and such husbands and to make them our best companions in this life and to make them our best companions in the Jannah, inshallah. My brothers and sisters, please understand and remember that the most painful of all suffering is regret. Ya laytani kuntu turaba. Ya laytani kuntu turaba. The person who denied Allah will say, I wish I was dust. Regret. He is not even asking for forgiveness. He is saying, I wish I didn't exist. I wish I was dust. The most painful of all suffering is regret. To know that it was so easy to make the right choice, but you didn't make it. To see the true colors of those friends who you thought were so cool and so sophisticated and so smart. To see them in all their ugliness of disobeying Allah. The one who gave them that intelligence which they use against him. What is worse than treason? What is worse than treason? You take something, you take the benefit from Allah and you use it against Allah. Of course you cannot harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the attempt of yours will yield its own fruit. The regret that will be so overwhelming that a person will bite his own hands and draw blood. But on that day, that blood will be of no avail. I want to remind you that when you are with good people, to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes easy. And to disobey Allah becomes difficult. But when you are with bad people, the opposite becomes true. It's easy to disobey Allah and it is difficult to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, choose your friends. I have a very simple rule. When I am choosing friends, shall I tell you what my rule is? Very simple rule. What is my rule? They all know the rules. My rule is, do I want this person to lead my Salatul Janazah? That's my rule. If the answer is yes, then the person is a good friend of mine. I will be his friend. If the answer is no, then I don't want his friendship. Because if that is a person I don't want to lead my Salatul Janazah, then why am I spending my life with him? For what? What is the best way of getting out of that? Give dawah to that friend. Either he will come on the right path or he will leave you. Both of these are good endings. Alhamdulillah. Do I want this person to lead my Salatul Janaza? That's my rule. I'm not talking about working relationships. We work with people who are Muslim, non-Muslim, practicing Muslims. There is no such thing as a non-practicing Muslim, unfortunately, so I can't use that terminology. Because if you're not practicing, you're not Muslim. So the NPM doesn't exist. Right? So therefore, you can work with them, no problem. You know, do business, buy, sell, whatnot. I'm talking about friendship, I'm talking about the heart, I'm talking about being close to somebody, confidant, someone with whom you want to spend some time and share some time and space. For that, is a different criteria. Different criteria. My brothers and sisters, let us remember that death can come at any time. So let us ensure that we are in the right company, because we know that we will be resurrected the way we died. And believe me, you and I don't want to die in a situation where when we are resurrected, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is looking, when all the ulama and the awliya of Allah are looking, when the anbiya are looking, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking, we are resurrected in a shameful situation. We don't want that, believe me. We do not want that. We do not want that. So let us ensure, how can you ensure that you are resurrected in a beautiful situation? By living in a beautiful situation. لا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. How can we do that? By living as Muslims. Do not die except in a state of Islam. How can I ensure that I do not die except in a state of Islam? By living in a state of Islam. Finally, I want to remind you once again, as we close, that the door has not been closed for anyone who is sitting here listening to this khutbah. Why? Because you are alive. Because you are alive. And therefore, the door of the choices, the thresholds are still open. Make the choice and make it quickly. Because we don't know when that door will slam shut. And when it shuts, it does not open. وصلى الله على نبي الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.